kõik saame sellest aru. Ja kui ei saa, siis aadele kohti ja keegi kõrval äkki tõigi. Ja mees pool.
I hope you're saying nice things about me, because I don't understand what you're saying. I'm going to be speaking in English. Unfortunately, I don't know Estonian very. Can you hear me? Do I need to be speaking?
Yeah.
You can hear me okay. Okay. In fact, I decided that I could probably speak English as fast as you guys can speak Estonian, which is extremely fast. But if I would do that, then nobody would hear anything. And I was already warned, will you please speak slowly and distinctly. And so that's why I decided that my little presentation here, I'm going to read so that I can say exactly what I want to say as slowly and distinctly as necessary. Okay? I like small towns. Small towns aren't for everybody, but if you feel good in a small town, better than in a city, then you should live in a small town. Except for some 15 years while I was studying at the university, I have lived in small towns all of my life. And that's quite a statement to make because I'm getting pretty old. I'm from the U.S., a U.S. citizen there. I lived there until 7.5 years ago when I put some things in a box, put the box on a boat, and sent it off to Estonia, to Viljandi, Estonia. Now, since things are straightened out with immigration, which they weren't all the time, I am now a permanent resident of Estonia. I found a home here in Viljandi. I renovated and finished the upstairs into a studio and a gallery. And if all goes well, I plan to spend the rest of my life here. My choice, and I think, and I underlined that and made it very capital. I'm here by choice. I'm not here because I was born here, or I had to come here, or I followed somebody here. I am here because I choose to be here. And when you think about that, that's really kind of important. And it doesn't say so much about me as it says about you and about this community. It says there is something here that people can actually make decisions to move here from some other distant land. A small Estonian town, by choice, Viljandi by choice. Even my work as an academic researcher in traditional cultures, I spent most of my time in small towns and countrysides. I'd fly into a city in Italy or Australia, India, Bolivia, Mongolia, or wherever, and I would immediately go into the Metz. I would head off to the forest someplace in the countryside to work. When my work was done, I would return to the city and fly home to my small town in the United States, to Colorado, where I lived and raised my family. I came amidst travels, research, and exploration to Estonia and to Viljandi, first in 2001. What is that, 16 years ago, right? I have worked typically with indigenous peoples in communities in distant places. I found myself, while I was working in these strange, unusual places that you can't even pronounce the name of them, I found myself looking over my shoulder all the time, every once in a while at least, and saying, maybe when it's time for me to sit in one place and finish my work, maybe this could be a place that I could do it in. And I did this on 6 continents. I'm being very truthful about this. I looked over my shoulder at places on 6 different continents and said, maybe one day I could come here. Maybe this could be a place to do it. In 2001, at an international study conference that I had been invited to speak at, I did just that. And the place was Viljandi. Can you imagine? Viljandi. That's where I looked over my shoulder and said, here's where I think I'll stay. First, I found an old, what I like to call a Makivi house. And a barn in a little Mogi village right south of here. Andres over here, who was speaking to us tonight, Andres helped me find it. I've known him for a long time. I spent summers there while working mostly in Asia, then returned to my Colorado home for the winter. In 2010, I sold my home in Colorado and moved to Viljandi. I had lived 39 years in a mountain town in Colorado, smaller than Viljandi. Its name was Estes Park, which is a very, very strange coincidence. And Estes was not Esti or Estonia. The old man whose name the town was named after was named Joel Estes. And Joel Estes, if you can imagine this place was so remote that it wasn't until 1861 that the first non-Indian or white or European human being was ever in this community. It was that remote, that far up into the mountains. You can see part of it right there, can't you? It was called Estes Park. It was the entrance to Rocky Mountain National Park. Before I left there, because I was in the habit of writing books, I partnered with a photographer friend to make a book about Estes Park. Estes Park was a good place. I called it Magic Place. You can see the name of it. The book up on the wall right now is called Magic in the Mountains, Estes Park, Colorado. But this was not the place I realized that when I was getting old, where I wanted to live and be quiet and alone. It was getting crazy, like popular places usually do, and it changed a lot in those many years. I'm going to show you some pictures, some photos from the book that is on there. And this book, by the way, this is the book. I scanned some photographs out of here. This is a book about the town, the small town, just 1/4 the size of Viljandi that I lived in. This book, by the way, is in the Viljandi Library. If anybody would like to ever see it, gone. Just give me a call. I've got a couple copies. Here are some photographs from the Magic Place in the Mountains, or the magic place in the mountains. The peak that you see there, the tallest peak, is, I gotta say it in feet first. It is 14,259 feet in altitude. How many meters is that, guys? How many meters is that? It's about 4,500 meters. It's a little bit more than 4,500 meters, and that is the mountain above the top. And you can see the hint of the little town, which is way down into this valley. Now that is all Rocky Mountain National Park up in there. And this is a little tiny town over there. And to get to this town, there are 3 ways to get there. One is to come over the top of the mountains from the west, which you could do about 3, sometimes 4 months out of the year. But the rest of the time is too much snow. And then there was one coming from one direction, way down in the valley, and one from another direction, way down in the valley, into a different direction. And so in the winter time, for 9 months out of the year, you could come there, but you had to turn around and go back again where you came from. It was this kind of remote place. Let me see if I'm doing this correctly now. It's not working. There's one. This is a panoramic picture of Long's Peak. And Long's Peak is over here. That is called the Money River. But this is the valley coming from the south. And it's very, very interesting. At least I always found that. And this is looking at the same valley, the same town, with the lake from another direction. This is, again, a view of the town in springtime when the trees are like they get here. In maybe 1 month, they'll be like that here. And the town is that low into the valley below these mountains. Here it is in wintertime. And in the wintertime, the animals that live up in the park in the summer come down into the wintertime. And the animal that you see here, in English, you call it an elk. But an elk is not the same as an elk in Europe. It is a different, and so these are more like a red deer, a great big huge red deer. And they come into town all the time, and you have to stop for them, because if you don't stop for them, you'll wreck your car. And that's the way it looks in the winter time in the snow. And here's, of course, in fall, this is a running path. And these are some views of the downtown area. And you can see that there's a downtown area. But if you go right behind these buildings, you're in the country already. That there's actually a river down between there. Now, the reason that this town looks so new, in a sense, is because over 20 some years, there were three floods that, and you say, as a flood in the mountains, what in the world are you talking about? A flood in the mountains? Two of them because there was 30 centimeters of rain in one day, and it created so much water that it simply absolutely flooded everything. It couldn't get away fast enough. And another time, up in the mountains, well, you're not seeing them now, but in the high country, it's called, was a lake that had a dam on the lake. And this lake was literally leased or sold to, the water from that lake was sold to another town that was about 50 kilometers down into the valley. And that town had not kept this dam up well enough. The dam broke one day, and huge amounts of water came, and it literally destroyed the entire center of the town. It literally just wiped everything out. There was so much water. There's a wall of water about this high. It just came right down the street. And of course, what happened is that when that's done, you have to make a new town. Because you can't restore it, you have to make it over again. So what we're seeing here a little bit is some of the new stuff. This is a building that survived. And this is the Dramatikogu, the public library, and this was the old library that really got messed up badly in one of the floods, and so they renovated it. My time is up. Okay, I will give you. Okay, here's one of the old buildings that also got beat up pretty badly, and here is a scene inside the town where the elk came into the village, and the visitors are standing there and talking about it. And here is a winter scene. There are two rivers that came into this town from two different places up in the park. And they came into town and met right at this particular place. And this is why water was a problem. I chose Viljandi in Estonia because I found the qualities that I desired at this time in my life. This is a place unique in almost every way. From my perspective, perhaps the most unique country and small town that I've ever experienced. I could recite 1,000 reasons, but I'll just share a few. The Estonian people, from my own perspective, the Estonian people and culture are strong and confident. I've heard the word spirit used to describe it. Estonians have a self-identity that is clear and precise. Estonians know who they are. And in our crazy world, that ends up, in my mind at least, being really quite important. Okay, another one. Estonians are still connected to the Mets. Still functioning awareness of our connection with nature and with the natural order. Three, Estonians are still pagan in a good sense. And some people find that valuable. I happen to find that really quite valuable. Four, Estonians tend to be gentle and respectful of others. Because I'm a pacifist, I find that I like the spirit of quiet non-aggression. So that's one of the reasons why I like it in this country and in this place. Nobody walks around saying, I'm a pacifist, what are you? They simply are, you're gentle people. It doesn't mean that you can't get angry, but you're not aggressive, assertive people that keep putting yourself in somebody else's face. Estonia is still focused on people, on people's well-being, on people's needs and desires. Here it is still possible to say that government, for example, exists to provide meaningful context within which people can live out their lives. The country that I came from in the U.S., it is no longer that way. And it's very worrisome because government is not any longer about the people. Estonians are kind, more so than any other people I have ever experienced. And then there's Viljandi, a place that squeezes all the attributes of its motherland and fatherland into one town along a little lake. And today there's this project, a time and place to discuss not business, not how to generate more money for a few already wealthy folks, but to discuss what can be done to make our community even more meaningful for its people and for the folks who might want to come and visit. I'm glad to be a part of this community, and I'm honored to be asked to share some of my personal feelings and thoughts about living in my adopted country and town. Thanks for letting me share my thoughts with you, Aija.
Say after 25 years, what would be your suggestion?
What will it look like?
Yes.
I'm a prophet now, right?
Go ahead.
Okay. I as you know, Estonia generally is becoming more modern, it's becoming more European, it is becoming more Western. I've lived here for, off and on, for 16 years, and I've seen a lot of changes. And some of the changes are changes which I say, oh, I wish it wouldn't change quite so quickly. It is becoming, in a sense, too European and less Estonian, for example. It is becoming that way. And I think that that will probably continue. And this could be a very, very bad thing, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. And the reason I'm saying this is, I feel personally very optimistic about this community, because the spirit of Estonian people is extremely strong. It is extremely strong. And I'm saying this because I have seen small towns in other countries, especially my own, who will never make it the same way because the people are not strong. And by strong, I don't mean this kind of strong. I mean, you know who you are. And my own feeling is that Viljandi, Estonia, will simply get better and better and better. And that's not necessarily a prediction. That is saying, based upon what I see, and based upon what I see as the spirit of the people, it's going to be here. It's going to grow in very, very good, positive directions.